Home Guide for Getting the Ramadan Vibe with Sheikh Shahad Ali at 8 o'clock, inshallah, this Friday. You can join us via YouTube and Facebook Live, inshallah. Again, if you have any questions or need of any assistance, please contact the ISOC office at 714-531-1722, or you can email us at office@isocmasjid.org. And don't forget to donate generously at give.isocmasjid.org, inshallah. Okay, Brother Ahmed, whenever you're ready, inshallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على مبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All the praise and thanks are due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah's peace and blessings be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and then all the prophets and the messengers sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the time of Adam alayhi salam to Nuh alayhi salam to Ibrahim alayhi salam to Musa alayhi salam, to Isa alayhi salam, to the final prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send his peace and blessing upon Muhammad and the companions of Muhammad and the wives of Muhammad and the household of Muhammad and the followers of Muhammad. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the followers of Muhammad. Say ameen, everybody. Ameen, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair, and thank you so much for being again with us in the third week of Heroes from Our Islamic History. And we have very actually amazing hero with us today, you know. The person we have today is a companion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and also an example of something that we call tabat in Arabic, perseverance. Somebody who defended Islam strongly. And usually when we talk about, if I want to tell you, if the word warrior comes to your mind, a soldier or a fighter comes to your mind, or even defender, sometimes, most probably, most of the time, unfortunately, we think only of men. You know, and we don't think that could be a woman, you know, but the hero that we're going to be talking about today is a woman. You know, she is a female companion of our Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she is from the Ansar. You know, her name is Nusayba bin Ka'b. She is from the clan of Al-Khazraj in Medina. Yathrib or Medina before Islam had two clans in it, Al-Aws and Khazraj. Majority of the people in Medina are from Al-Khazraj, and she's from Al-Khazraj. Nusayba bin Ka'b is a very interesting woman, and a woman who accepted Islam among the first people of Medina to accept Islam. We know from the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that at the 10th year of Hijrah, six people from Medina came and met Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Mecca and accepted Islam. And the following year, they brought 12 people with them to accept Islam, and the historians and the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called it the Pledge of Aqaba, Bay'at al-Aqaba al-Ula, the first Pledge of Aqaba. The following year, about 75 people or 73 people came to accept Islam and to pledge allegiance to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Islam. Among those 73 people or 75 people, according to which historians, two women, among them are two women. One of them is our hero of today, Nusayba bint Ka'b. And not only her that she came with her husband, with her two sons, and some of the historians, they tell us she came with her daughter and also her brother and sister. So mashallah, almost her entire family came to accept Islam at the Pledge of Aqaba, the second Pledge of Aqaba. And the second Pledge of Aqaba wasn't just accepting Islam. Accepting Islam is to accept to defend the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Islam and the people of Mecca. That's why Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the second Pledge of Aqaba, he allowed the Muslims of Mecca to migrate, to do the hijrah from Mecca to Medina, because the people of Medina, the people of Yathrib, promised Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that they accept, not just accepted Islam, but also their prophet, they will protect Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companion. I want to talk about something before I talk about the life of Nusayba. I think we need to have introduction to the life of Nusayba. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, when they accepted Islam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they valued Islam and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam different than the way we value them. And that's true and that's reality. Why is that? Because those people came from darkness, from pre-Islamic era of jahiliyyah, of ignorance to Islam. So they saw the pains, the issues, the problems that they had to go before Islam. And then when they came to Islam, they saw the light of Islam. As if they were in so dark, in darkness, in deep darkness, and then Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam took them to the light of Islam. So the way they see Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is different than we see him. The way they see Islam is different than they see Islam. So they hold Islam tight, and they actually defended Islam with everything they have. And that's what we're going to see with Nusaybah radiallahu anha. Because for us, unfortunately, sometimes some of us, you know, all of us will take Islam for granted. We'll take Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for granted. Who thought ever that we were not going to be able to pray Taraweeh in Ramadan in the masjid? No one ever thought that. And I think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us nowadays a wake-up call to wake up from the feeling that we always take things for granted. That's always we're going to have these things. We're entitled for things and we have to fight for things. So, inshallah, this is going to be assignment for all of us tonight, inshallah. We're going to not take things for granted after, inshallah, we come out of this, inshallah, situation that we're in. And we need to promise ourselves that things that we took for granted and we didn't do much before, that we should do again, inshallah, after the situation that we're, after we get out of the situation, inshallah, that we're in. So Nusaybah understood this, and she had her entire family around this meanings of defending what? Defending Islam and Muslim. You know, and subhanAllah, you know what? I think about it all the time when I think about, you know, we're talking about, you know, women to be a hero, you know, women to be warriors, you know. And I say this, and I'm proud of that. I'm a father of two daughters, as most of you know, that, you know what? Our sisters, they fight and defend Islam every single day when they leave the house with their hijab. And that's their jihad. And now we're in a situation as men, you know, we don't do that sometimes, and easily we can blend and hide our identity. But for our sisters to leave their house with their hijab and to present Islam, that requires a lot of courage and requires to be brave. And I think, you know what, the best example of that is Nusaybah bin Ka'b radiallahu anha. We know Nusaybah bin Ka'b radiallahu anha participated in many battles. And she participated in the battles at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what, fighting the battles, was it only for men or only men can do that? Yes, not a lot of women at that time were fighting the battles, but, you know, women still participated in the battles and fighting in the battles, and also sometimes being the nurses to help the wounded and injured in, from the battles. So Nusaybah radiallahu anha, her and her family participated in the Battle of Uhud. And very interesting to know about the Battle of Uhud, that the Muslim at the beginning of the battles, they were winning the battle. You know, actually, they were winning the battles. That Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam let some of the archers be in Tabufa Hill. Those archers, when they saw the army of the Meccan retreating and fleeing the battlefield, they ran down to the battlefield. And actually, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked them not to leave, but they left and they made that mistake. But who saw this opportunity? Khalid bin Walid at that time, who was a Muslim, and he came around the Muslims and he kind of crushed the Muslims into the mountain of Uhud. So many of the Muslims started fleeing the battlefield to the mountain. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left, and Nusaybah said that. He said, we were left in the battlefield and only 9 of us and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our 10th. There were only 10 people left in the battlefield, 9 people plus Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And who are those 9 people? Nusaybah, her husband, her 2 sons. So 4 of them, almost half of them, were Nusaybah and her family, radiallahu anhum. They were fighting and protecting Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when the Meccans, they tried to, and they saw Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they start to attack Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nusaybah started defending Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said himself, he said, in the day of Uhud, whenever I looked on my right or left, on the front of me or flying back, I always saw Nusaybah protecting me. And something very interesting, that her son gets injured in this battle, when there were only 10 of them, or 9 of them, plus Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the battlefield, her son gets injured. So she ran to her son and she rubbed his wound. At the same time, after she rubbed his wound, she told him, get up and go defend the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Go defend Islam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at her and said, Nusaybah, not all of us can bear this. Not all of us can handle this. Not all of us can see our kids being injured and continue defending Islam. And we are in a time that we see our kids not injured for and not any sake, but we're so scared, you know, and worried about them. And we don't want anything to happen to them. Those Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, may Allah be pleased with them, they understood that it's so important to defend the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And defending Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is defending Islam. And we're going to find this now, why Nusaybah and her family defended Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Nusaybah got a big hit on her shoulder. So actually some of the historians of Sirah, they say it took her a year, you know, to heal from her wound that was in her shoulder. But when the battle, when Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and then they were able to escape the battlefield and run into the mountain. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at the Sayyidah and her family, and he said, what a wonderful family, what a great family. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. And the Sayyidah, she looked at Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to ask you something. Can you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us, me and my family, your companion of Jannah? Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he put his hand together and he said, oh Allah, make them my companions in Jannah. That's what the Sayyidah was looking for. She's looking to be the companion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not in this life only, but in the hereafter. So she and her family did everything they can do to be able to be Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. And then when she heard the dua of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and what he said, the Sayyidah said something so beautiful, so profound. He said, I don't care what happens to me after this. After what Prophet, the dua that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made, and what Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made, the dua that he made for me and my family to be with him in Jannah, I don't care what happened, you know. If anything happened, I'm good, because I'm going to be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. And that was the higher goal and the higher purpose of Nusaybah and her family. Their goal in life, they aim for something high. They aim to be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. And in order for them to be in Jannah, they have to show, and to be with the Prophet Hassan Jannah, they have to show in this life that they deserve the position to be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah, and if he's highest place in Firdaus, and highest place in Al-Wasila, can we be with him? We wish to be with him, and we can be with him, but we have to show him that we want to be with him, that we deserve to be with him, Prophet Muhammad, to be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Another situation of Nusaybah. Nusaybah had similar situation in the Battle of Hunayn. The Battle of Hunayn, when Prophet Muhammad, after the conquest of Mecca, after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam brought Islam back to Mecca, and he conquered Mecca, the tribe of Thaqif, they prepared to fight Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took a big army. And actually the army was of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time about 10,000 Muslims in the army. And they were ready to fight the tribe of Thaqif in the Battle of Hunayn. Abu Bakr actually looked at the army and he said, we are not going to be defeated today because we are small in numbers. We cannot be defeated because we are small in numbers. Because in the past, Muslims, when they went through the battle, they had small numbers of in their armies. So Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went with the army, but they were surprised by the tribe of Thaqif in the middle of the valley, and they saw throwing rocks on them. So many people fled the battlefield. Again, similar situation of Uhud. Many of the Muslims started fleeing the battlefield, and a few people stood with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who also stood with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that spot, in Hunayn, also our hero of today, Nusaybah radiallahu anha. And she starts shouting on the people, don't repeat this habit, don't do what you're doing, why are you running away? And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was able to gather again the Muslims and then to win the battle of the Allahu an Nusaybah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her and her family. Something also very interesting happened to Nusaybah radiallahu anha later on at the end of the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know from the seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at the end of his life, some people came out claiming to be prophets. And one of them is Musaylimah. Musaylimah, he's known to be Musaylimah al-Kadhab, Musaylimah the liar. He was in the place of Yamama. And Yamama is the central of Arabia, where is Riyadh and all Najd, all this central of Arabia right nowadays. Musaylimah came and he claimed to be a prophet. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose a messenger from him to send a message from Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to Musaylimah, the liar, the one who claimed to be a prophet. Who was that? The Prophet Muhammad, who did he choose? He chose Habib, the son of Nusaybah radiallahu anha. He chose him and he said, go with this message to Musaylimah. And I tell him that he's not a prophet and he's exposed, and he actually tried to come up with surahs of the Quran. He heard that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam revealed Surah Al-Fil, and he came up with an interesting verses about the elephant. He said, Al-Filum Al-Fil, and what do you know about Fil? It has a long nose. It's just something that's ridiculous, something not even close to the Quran, you know? So Habib radiallahu anhu, he went to Musaylimah and he conveyed the message to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But what Musaylimah did, he captured Habib as a prisoner. He was a messenger. And at that time, until now, even if people are at war, they cannot kill messengers when they say the same messages. So Musaylimah captured him and said, and he tried to force him to believe in him. And every single time tell him, you believe in me? He said, no, I don't believe in you. Who do you believe in? He said, I believe in Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his messenger. And he kept torturing him, until he killed him and he threw his body in the fire. So the news came back to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam actually was upset of what he did. And the news reached to Nusaybah radiallahu anha, and they told her how her son died in a very brutal way. And actually, she said something so profound. She said, when they told her how her son died, he said, I prepared him for that. I prepared him for something like that. And I counted him with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I counted that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give me the reward of being patient and be giving me the reward that I prepare him to be in that situation to defend Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and messenger, and not to give up to people who are falsely claim to be prophets and trying to change Islam. Subhanallah, that's a family. That's not her son was able to accept this torture and defend Islam and defend Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam because the way she raised him. And because who she was a defender of Islam, radiyallahu anha, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with her, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with all, her family. And later on, we know from the seerah that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, and Abu Bakr sent an army to Al-Yamama to fight Musaylimah al-Kadhab for the killing that he did in the Muslim, and herself, Musaylimah participated in that battle, actually. She participated in that battle, and some of the historians of Sirah tell us that she got 13 wounds in that battle, and she was brought back to Medina after this battle, and then later on she passed away. But I want to tell you something very interesting about the characteristic and the quality of Nusaybah radiallahu anha. Nusaybah once came to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, when I read the Quran, when I recite the Quran, it's only talking about men, talking about what the men is going to get, or talking to men. Because sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will use the masculine to talk to the community, and not using the feminine verbs or the feminine words. So she said, I don't see anything for the women. She said, So I don't see the women that be mentioned in the Quran. And subhanallah, because of her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed ayah number 35 in Surah Al-Ahzab, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إن المسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات والقانتين والقانتات والصادقين والصادقات والصابرين والصابرات والخاشعين والخاشعات والصادقين والصادقات والصائمين والصائمات والحافظين فروجهم والحافظات. Usually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he talks to us, he said, oh, the Muslims, the Muslimin or Muslimun, or the الذين آمنوا, talking mainly to the entire community in a masculine way. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed his ayah and he said, indeed, the Muslim men and the Muslim women, the believing men and the believing Muslim, the believing women, the obedient men and the obedient women, the truthful men and the truthful women, all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ أَجْزًا عَظِيمًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for them, أَعَدَّ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ مَغْفِرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for them forgiveness, وَأَجْزًا عَظِيمًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for them a great reward. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of her, because how, she thought, and she asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, why we don't we have something for the women? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarified that everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals in the Quran, it's for men and women. And the rewards, men and women are looked at by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala equally. It's not like men looked at better by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or women looked less by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reward for men and women is the same in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said here, and the terrible men and the terrible women, the fasting men and the fasting women. So all this deed that men and women they do, they're equal in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we thank for that. We thank Nusaybah, who clarified this when she asked Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the question. So shortly three years after the death of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nusaybah passed away and she left a legacy behind her. Legacy of perseverance, legacy of defending Islam. And the question that I think we all should ask ourselves right now, how can we be like her? How can we defend Islam? She aimed to be the companion of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah and in this life. And she was able to accomplish both of them in the life of Prophet, in her life, during her life, because she worked so hard to achieve her goals. So what is your motivation? What would move you? Do you want to be with Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah? Who do you want to meet in Jannah? Do you want to meet Nusaybah to tell you about her story in this life? And I wish that would happen, honestly. I would love to go, inshallah, to Jannah with all of us here, inshallah, and tell Nusaybah that we talked about her, to tell us about her story again, so we can hear from her. So think about what's your motivation and what's your goal, what you want to aim, and what kind of action are you doing to be with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah. Jazakum Allah khair. And inshallah, we'll end with dua, inshallah, as usual. And we'll see you, inshallah, on Thursday, inshallah. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولأزواجنا ولذرياتنا ولأهلينا ولأصحابنا ولطلبتنا ولمعلمينا ولمن أوصانا واستوصانا بدعاء الخير ولمن له حق علينا. اللهم ارفع عنا البلاء، اللهم ارفع عنا البلاء، اللهم ارفع عنا البلاء. يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث، اصلح لنا شأننا كله ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من البرص والجنون والجذام وسيء الأسقام. اللهم احفظنا بعينك التي لا تنام، اللهم احفظنا بعينك التي لا تنام، اللهم احفظنا بعينك التي لا تنام، وتب علينا واغفر لنا يا الله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون، وسلام على المرسلين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. جزاكم الله خير، and we'll see you إن شاء الله on Thursday. السلام عليكم.